All right, so good afternoon, everyone. Again, this is lecture number 25, I believe. So this is lecture number 26. And today we'll be talking about the interpretation of rate of deformation tensor. So we briefly introduced the rate of deformation tensor DIJ in lecture number 24 before going to a quick discussion on stretch ratios and coming back again to our rate of deformation tensor. So we'll quickly introduce what it is again, and then we'll start our discussion on the interpretation of this D in terms of its geometrical interpretation, the way we did for strain tensor epsilon. All right, so before that, we have some announcements. So I have uploaded problem set number 4. The PS4 is now available on Moodle. So please have a look at it. Please try to attempt this problem set. This is mainly on the first part of kinematics, that is on material derivative, some understanding of deformations and the tensor associated with it. And then we have a problem on working with deformations, some particular kind of deformations. Okay, so that's problem set 4. I've also uploaded a computer assignment. This computer assignment is completely optional. It's not compulsory. It is not a part of the evaluation. But for those who enjoy programming, you will appreciate it, especially because the equations that we'll be working with in continuum mechanics have to be solved. Yeah, so in a real world scenario, we have to solve these equations using computers because closed form analytical solutions of these equations in most cases are not available with us. So the assignment involves a particular scenario of irrotational flows, as we'll be discussing in the next lecture. Talks about the equation. The equation actually is a Laplace's equation, which you already have seen in your mathematics course, hopefully. You have to solve the Laplace's equation with for a particular domain and boundary conditions using a numerical approach. So it's quite descriptive, the assignment. It's a 4-page assignment. There's different steps to it. So if you continue with the different steps, you will be able to model the system and solve the equations. And I've also given some checks for you to compare your results against. Again, you can use Python if you want. Python's the language that's been taught these days in computing, first year computing. Python's also a very popular language these days. If you can use that, that'll be good. You can also use MATLAB if you feel comfortable with that, or any other programming language. Now, if you don't feel like solving the equation by using a numerical approach, then you can use the standard PDE toolbox available in MATLAB. It also allows you to numerically solve the equations without worrying about the mathematics behind it. So you have to feed the system graphically and give the options of the parameters, and then it will solve using a finite element method and give you the solution that you can compare. So as engineers, we definitely have to solve these equations, and continuum mechanics tends to become very theoretical. So if you want to get some understanding or a feeling of what typical engineers do while working with continuum mechanics, this is your chance. Also towards the end, if you really feel like doing some heavy duty computing, then you can parallelize your program, parallelize your code. And if you need some time on the HPC cluster, I'll be happy to give you some time on the HPC cluster for running your simulations in parallel. Okay, so please let me know. And again, this assignment is completely optional, but it'll definitely help you with developing your computing skills, which are very important these days in terms of employability. All right, so the agenda for today. We will do a quick recap of the velocity gradient and it's decomposition. Then we will work on the interpretation. Of the rate of deformation tensor Dij. All right, so let's start. Now, I told you earlier that when we are dealing with fluids, then we only work with the spatial or the Eulerian coordinates. We don't tend to use material coordinates. I mean, you can use them, and many people do use them in certain situations, but most commonly, it's the Eulerian understanding that we use. So in the Eulerian understanding or the spatial understanding, we have spatial points. Well, if we have a spatial point P, small p, and all we're interested in is to understand the deformation or the rate of deformation in this case at that spatial point P. It's not a material point, it's a spatial point. All right, so let's say the velocity at point P is denoted by the velocity vector vi, and then since we always see what's happening around the point P, so we find a point q, small q, which is and the vector from small p to small q is d small x vector, and the velocity at the relative velocity at point q with respect to p is dv. So the actual velocity is something like vi plus dvi. So our aim is to understand how dvi changes as a function of d small x vector. If we can do that, then we have information about everything that's happening around point P. All right. So using our rules of calculus, we can write dvi as del vi by del small x j times dxj. Right, so this is what I mean, the first part is what our L tensor is, which we call the velocity gradient tensor. Lij. Now again, the same way as we did for displacement or displacement gradient, we can write Lij as a sum of its symmetric part and a skew symmetric part. Okay, so Dij is given as Vi comma j, which is Lij, plus Vj comma I, and half of that. So Dij is defined as half of Vi comma j plus Vj comma I. Okay, so that's a symmetric part of Lij. So this is called the deformation. Rate of deformation tensor. Now let's link these ideas to what we already have learned. So the displacement gradient tensor, that was ui comma j, that we developed for solids, was written as a sum of its symmetric part, which was epsilon. So epsilon is the counterpart of d here, and epsilon was the deformation, or epsilon was a strain tensor. It's a strain tensor at the information about deformation. So the strain is zero, then the deformation is zero, as we know. So in this case, we're talking about a velocity, which is the rate of change of displacement. So corresponding to deformation, we have a rate of deformation now. Okay, so this Dij tells us at what rate the body is deforming, because it's a continuous deformation that's happening. So at what rate or how fast is the body deforming in this case? Okay, so Dij, the symmetric part, contains information about rate of deformation of the body at that point P. So that's a rate of deformation tensor. Okay, so whatever was deformation earlier is now rate of deformation. And the other part, which is a skew symmetric part, that's W, which is defined as half of Vi comma j minus V j comma I. So that's the skew symmetric part. It's called the vorticity or spin tensor. Okay, again, if we compare that with our omega tensor, that was a rotation, infinitesimal rotation tensor. Now, that told us how much is the body rotating in a rigid body rotation. Now, this tells us at what rate the body is rotating for rigid body motion. Okay, so W still contains information about rigid body motion, but this is now the rate of rotation or vorticity or spin tensor. Okay, again, we will analyze this in detail in the next lecture on Friday. But today, we'll be talking about the understanding of Dij in particular. Right, so as a summary, we can write the relative displacement of Q with respect to P, dV, as L dot dx. Okay. We should write it here. Okay, so we just need to develop a relation between F dot and L in this case. So let's do that first. That is something we'll be using in the next few steps. So our L tensor, which is del Vi by del Xj, can be written as del Vi by del capital Xa times del capital Xa by del Xj, okay, using the chain rule. So there's a summation over the index A here, because small x is a function of capital X, or capital X A, capital X is a function of small x in this case. So I can split this L tensor, which is Lij, as del Vi by del capital Xa times del capital Xa divided by del small xj. Now the first term in this can be written as the time rate of change of del xi, small xi, by del capital Xa. Because we know that the velocity v is nothing but d by dt of small xi, right? So this d by dt, the quantity in the bracket, is nothing but our F tensor. If you remember that, that's your deformation gradient tensor, F tensor. And then the other one that you have is nothing but your F inverse. So as a summary, we can write the L tensor in the symbolic notation as F dot times F inverse. So F with a dot on the top means the time rate of change of F. So if I post multiply with F on both sides, what I get is F dot is equal to L dotted with an F. Okay. Okay, so f dot is a time derivative of the deformation gradient tensor f, and L, as you know, is the velocity gradient tensor. So we can see that the L tensor that we have started to use now can be calculated using the F tensor and its time derivative. Okay. So this equation is quite useful. We'll be using that a lot in our expressions. Okay. So now that we have developed this relation, let's start interpreting D. Okay, so for that we'll start with the stretch ratio that that's the reason we spent a lecture on that. So the stretch ratio lambda, as you know, is defined by d small x by d capital X. Don't need to define that again. We already understand this is a stretch ratio. So let's start with our velocity gradient tensor. So dxi, the f tensor. So dxi can be written as xi comma a d capital x a, where this is nothing but your fia. So this is a known relation. There's nothing new here. So we will start with this expression and then go to interpreting our rate of deformation tensor t. Okay, so d small xi can be written as xi comma a times dx. Okay, so remember that in working with velocities, although we don't tend to use a material approach, but we can still use it. We can always define something at t equals zero as our material coordinate system. So as the material configuration or the reference configuration. So it's always possible to work with it. So we will start using it, but the final result will not include any material interpretation. All right, we can multiply and divide the numerator and sorry, we can multiply the numerator and denominator by d small x. So this becomes dxi by dx magnitude times ds magnitude. And then on the right hand side, we multiply and divide by d capital X magnitude. Okay. So what we are left with, so the first thing is nothing but the small n vector. Remember, the small n vector was defined as a unit vector in the direction of dxi times dx. On the right hand side, you have xi comma a times capital N a d capital X. So we simply have used the definition of our unit vectors in the deformed configuration and the undeformed configuration. Alright, so now I can divide both sides by d capital X. So this becomes ni times the stretch ratio lambda equals xi comma a times ni. And in fact, xi comma a, as you know, is nothing but our f tensor. So we can write this as fia. Again, nothing new here, just manipulating the equations and the definitions of different terms. All right, so in the symbolic notation, I can write this as n vector times lambda, and now lambda is a scalar, which is equal to f dot n hat. So this is the equation that we'll start working with to start interpreting our rate of deformation tensor Dij. Okay, so what we do now is we take a material derivative of both sides. That's d by dt of both sides. So on the left hand side, we get n times lambda with a dot on the top means d by dt of lambda plus n dot times lambda is equals to f dot dotted with n hat. Times f dotted with n hat dot. Okay, so dot on the top means material derivative, that is d by dt. So we have used a product rule for differentiation. Okay, so the last term on the right hand side is zero because you know by definition capital N is in the reference coordinate system, which is not a function of time. If you try to see how capital N is changing with time, that is zero because capital N has nothing to do with time. It is fixed for t equal to zero. It remains as it is for all times. Okay, so this last term becomes zero. So what we can do is we can divide all the terms by lambda. So that gives us n hat lambda dot by lambda plus n hat is f dot. Now actually I can substitute f dot if I go back a slide. Now we defined f dot as L times f, as you can see on the screen. So I can replace my f dot with L times f, this dotted with n hat divided by lambda. Now, f times n hat, which we already have this expression. So I can replace f dot n hat with n lambda. So this becomes L times n hat times lambda divided by lambda. So be careful with the dots and all. With what is vector, what is scalar. So lambda is a scalar, so there's no problem with that. But L times n hat has to be a dot. It's an inner product, not an outer product. Now with initial notation, things are a bit more clear, but we're using symbolic notation here. Okay, so lambda cancels scalar. So what we are left with is n lambda dot by lambda plus n hat equals L dot n hat. So I'll summarize that equation here. Sorry, I made a mistake. There was an n hat dot. So the dot over the second term in the last equation on the left hand side was missing. It has to be n hat dot. All right, so writing the equation again on the new page, n hat dot plus n hat times lambda dot by lambda is equals to L dot n hat. So we're not done yet. We still have to do a bit more massaging of the equation. So what we can do is we can take a dot product with small n hat on both sides. Now, on the right hand side, if you want to understand it, L dot n hat simply is Lij nj. So if I take a dot product with n again, then I end up, there's only one free index here, that is I, if I end up doing. So if I write the initial notation, this is much more clear. So this term on the right hand side is only Lij Nj. If I take a dot product on the right hand side, all I actually get is n dot l dot n. Again, symbolic notation can be quite clear here. I just wanted to avoid the indices. But if I take a dot on the right hand side of the top equation, we end up getting n dot l dot n, because l dot n with a dot on the right hand side has no meaning here. Right. Now we can simplify things a bit. So what we see now is in the second term we have an n dot n, and we know that n dot n is a 1. It's a unit vector dot unit vector. That's 1. And now the first term is the time derivative of n hat dotted with an n hat. Now that is 0. Easiest way to see that is you have n dot n is equal to 1. So d by dt of n dot n is equal to 0. And if you expand the left hand side, this becomes twice n hat dot n hat, that is 0. So your n hat dot okay, so if you use n dot n equal to 1 and n dot dot n equal to 0, so what we are left with is lambda dot by lambda is equal to n dot l dot n. Now, which in the initial notation is nothing but ni lij nj, which is a scalar. Okay, there's no free index on the right hand side. Now, let's understand what the left hand side lambda dot by lambda means. So, this lambda dot by lambda is called the rate of stretching. Remember that lambda is stretch ratio. So it was the ratio of the final length to the initial length of the vector. Now lambda dot would mean the rate at which the vector is stretching. So the vector is increasing in size with every second. What that means is lambda dot is a positive quantity. If the vector increases but then stops, then lambda initially was non-zero but then becomes zero. Okay, so lambda dot at any time tells us the rate of stretching of the vector d capital X. It's called rate of stretching, but it's divided by lambda. So this is rate of stretching per unit stretch. Now, for what element are we talking about? So this is rate of stretching per unit stretch for an element which was originally in the n hat direction and now in small n hat direction currently. Okay, so currently it is in the small n hat direction. So this lambda dot by lambda simply tells us what's the rate of stretching of a vector with time, and that division by lambda simply is for normalizing it. It doesn't tell us anything interesting here. Okay, that's just a normalization. Now you can also see that this lambda dot by lambda can also be written as d by dt of the natural log of lambda. So lambda dot by lambda can be written as d by dt of ln lambda If you do that, you get lambda dot by lambda. So it's also it's this this quantity is also called the logarithmic rate of stretching. So the word logarithmic rate of something, so whenever you have something dot by that something, you can always write that as d by dt of that something. So that becomes logarithmic rate of that something. Okay. So logarithmic rate of, I mean, it's a very common terminology. So that's the reason I included that here. But again, it's simply lambda dot by lambda written in a different form. Right, so we still haven't figured out how to interpret d yet, but we are getting there. So let's write this whole thing again. So lambda dot by lambda, which is the rate of stretch per unit stretch, is equal to ni lij nj. Now remember what lij was. Lij was written as a sum of dij plus wij nj, where d was a symmetric part and w was the skew symmetric part. So I can expand this. So we have two terms here, ni dij nj and ni wij nj. Now, can somebody figure out why the second term is zero? So the second term, that is ni wij nj, the whole term is zero. Because here we have a product of a symmetric tensor and a skew symmetric tensor. So ni nj is symmetric and wij is skew symmetric. Okay, so we already have learned this in the mathematics part. That if you have aij times bij, where a is symmetric and b is skew symmetric, then the double dot product is always zero. We have shown that easily. So this term is zero. So basically, lambda dot by lambda simply is ni dij nj. So now you can see that we have got d into the picture. So we will use this equation to understand what is the interpretation of d. Again, you may have guessed that the technique is very similar to what we have been doing in the past. Now we can see here that n, the small n vector, is arbitrary right now. But what we can do is we can say that let n hat be in the coordinate direction E1. If we do that, then lambda dot by lambda becomes d 1 1. Okay. So if n hat is equal to E1, then this becomes d 1 1. So what that means is d 1 1 is the so d11 is a rate of stretch per unit stretch in the E1 direction. Now again, if you compare that to epsilon, it's very similar. The diagonal terms of epsilon were the longitudinal strains. So the change in length per unit length in the coordinate directions. This is the rate of change. It's a dot. It's rate of stretch per unit stretch in the E1 direction. Okay. Similarly, D22 and D33 have similar interpretation. Now, what we can also see as a side, if your n hat, now if we choose n hat in a different direction, if n hat is an eigen direction of D. Okay. So n hat can be any direction. Initially, we took n hat as E1, E2, or E3. That gives us D11, D22, and D33. But if n hat is an eigen direction of Dij, then lambda dot by lambda, that becomes now you know that Dij times nj is equal to some constant times ni. That's the definition of eigendirection. Ax equals lambda x. So dn equals d1n. And this becomes equal to d1. So what that means is that the eigenvalues of d give us the rate of stretch per unit stretch in the corresponding eigen direction. Okay, that's also an interesting interpretation of the eigenvalues of D, which is given as the rate of stretch per unit stretch in the eigen direction. Remember that we try to interpret what the different terms of D mean. All right, so that was aside from understanding the diagonal terms of D. Now the next step is to understand what the off diagonal terms of D mean. Now again, the exercise is very similar to what we have been doing. To understand the off-diagonal terms, we must first take two vectors. So at that point P, we take two vectors, the first one being dx1 and the second one being dx2, and the angle between these two vectors, let it be theta. Okay. So now what we'll do is we will take the dot product between these two. Again, very similar to what we have been doing in the past for interpreting the off-diagonal terms of epsilon. Let's write dx1 dot dx2, which as you know is written as dx1 magnitude, dx2 magnitudes times cos theta. Right. So we'll call this as 1. Now we take the left hand side of this and we will take a material derivative of that. So we will take a material derivative of the left hand side. So when you do that, this simply becomes dx1 with a dot on top times dx2 plus so a dot on the top is nothing but the rate of change, time rate of change of that quantity. Okay. So this d by dt of dx1 simply becomes d v1. I can take the time derivative inside. Okay. Now this the differential velocity or the relative velocity of point, let us call these points as points Q and R. So the relative velocity of point Q with respect to P is dV1, can be written as, let's write in the initial notation that will make things a bit easier. So I can write this as, well, let's first write this in the initial notation. That's dvi dx 2i so I can write dvi1 as vi comma j times dx j1. So dvi is written as vi comma j dxj, and the vector 1 on top goes on dx, because vi comma j has nothing to do with 1 or 2. It's basically the it contains information about all the points around P. Okay, so we have simply replaced dv by vi comma j dxj.
Okay.
Right. So now what we do is, let's see these terms. Dxi has a, it's a 2. On the right hand side, on the second term, we have dxj with a 2. So what we do is, in one of these terms, we'll replace I with j. So what we do in the first term is replace an I with j, and then we write this, the first term becomes dx1i, and the second term becomes dx2j. And the second term and the final term remains as it is. So the reason we did all this is to make sure that our dxi1 dxj2 is can be taken common in this expression, right? So now what we'll do is we'll take dxi1 dxj2 common. So what we get is vj comma I plus vi comma j let's check that. So d by dt of dx1 dot dx2 is vj comma I plus vi comma j times dxi1 dxj2. So this is d by dt of dx1 dot least. Right. Right. And then the first term, as you can see, is nothing but twice of dij. So vi comma j plus vj comma I was twice the rate of deformation tensor. So we pause this intermediate step, and then what we'll do is we'll start with the right hand side of the previous expression. So I'll call this A, and I'll use this later. So let's go back and look at the right hand side of one. Now what we'll do is we'll take the material derivative of the right hand side and then equate A and B. In the second step, we take d by dt of dx1 magnitude, dx2 magnitude, cos theta. So this, again, we can apply the product rule. So this becomes cos theta dot becomes minus sine theta. So we can absorb the minus sine on the left hand side here, and then we have theta with a dot on top. So sine theta, and write it more neatly. This is right. So that's if you take the material derivative of dx1 magnitude, dx2 magnitude times cos theta. So we can now multiply and divide by dx1, dx2 magnitudes. So this becomes dx1 dot we can take the cos theta common as well. So that okay, so this is our equation number B. So there's a lot of algebra here, but we are almost there now. So what we see is that A and B are nothing but the material derivative of the dot product of dx1 and dx2. So that means that we can equate A and B, because from one we can see that if two quantities are equal, the time rate of change is also equal. So by equating A and B, what we get is twice dij And since we had dx1, dx2 common, so I'll divide that on the left-hand side to simplify things. So by equating a and b, we have this equation. All right. So this is very important for us for the analysis. So we will. So all that we did was simply to arrive at this equation. Now you can see in this equation. Let's use a particular case now. So what we'll do is we will. So in this case, let's just simplify this a bit further to make things a bit more easier. This, if we go back, so the first dxi1 by dx1 magnitude is nothing but n1 vector. And the second one is n2 vector. That's my left hand side. Now on the right hand side, sorry. On the right hand side, we have dx1 dot by dx1. So that's, well, in fact, what we'll do is we will take a situation. So let's erase that. For n1 perpendicular to n2. Because remember that we chose n1 and n2. So if I go back to the figure, we chose a q and r in such a way so that there was an angle theta between them. But we can always choose them in such a way so that dx1 vector and dx2 vector are perpendicular to each other. So that's in our choice. So if we restrict our equation to the situation where n1 vector and n2 vectors, small n1 and small n2, are perpendicular to each other, so then we are left with this simply is the same as what we wrote earlier. On the right hand side, the cos theta term becomes zero. So cos theta, which is this one, it goes to zero because theta is equal to 90 degrees to start with. So then if this term becomes zero, so all we are left with is minus sine theta times theta. Now sine theta of course is 1 because theta is 90 degrees. So actually we are left with this minus theta naught. Okay. So I can summarize this equation. In fact, I can also write this equation as n1 dot twice d dot n2 equals minus. Okay, so this right hand side is the rate of decrease of theta. It's a theta dot with a minus sign. So theta dot means the rate of increase of theta with time, and minus sign means rate of decrease of theta with time. So that simply tells us how are the two vectors, that's your dx1 and dx2, how are they closing towards each other as time increases. Okay. And the left hand side is the shear rate between the elements in direction of n1 and okay. So again, it's an angle change. So the left hand side tells us if you have n1 and n2 as two vectors perpendicular to each other in the beginning, how is this element shearing with time? So that's a shear rate. So again, as we have been doing in the past, what we do now is we take the situation where n1, let our n1 is equal to e1, and n2 is equal to e2. So if you do that, then we are left with this twice d12. So again, this is a particular case. This becomes equal to minus theta naught. And this is the interpretation of the off diagonal terms of d. So d12 tells us that if you have a point p, small p, sorry, let's say you have e1, e2, and e3. So if I take an n1 in e1 direction, that's your dx1, and I take a dx2 in my e2 direction, which are initially at right angles to each other, then as time goes along, then how is the angle between these two changing with time? Okay. The rate of change of that angle, or the minus of the rate of change of that angle, is called twice d12. So we can write d12 as minus half times theta. Okay, similarly, we can interpret the other terms of off diagonal terms of D. Okay, so that gives us some confidence as to what the different terms of the rate of deformation tensor D mean to us. Now, again, this rate of deformation tensor is extremely important, especially in fluid mechanics, the way epsilon or the strain tensor is important for solid mechanics. Now, this D, as you can see by definition, so D is symmetric. By definition, because D was defined as a symmetric part of our velocity gradient tensor, so that means our principal direction and values, we can use the same ideas. The spherical part and deviatoric part can again be defined using the same ideas as earlier. Okay, so everything that we could do on sigma and epsilon, we can do on D as well, because it is a symmetric second order tension. Okay, we can also draw more circles. Okay, so let's stop here today. And in the next lecture, we'll talk in detail about the interpretation of W, which is your spin or the vorticity tensor. Do we have any questions?